a lot of French words in there, weren't it? Yeah, yes. You did it pretty well. I'm sorry, I asked for a podium to put my notes here. There is so much to be said about the state of digital media and so little time. I'd rather just stick to my script, otherwise you just push on play and I can go forever. So very, very happy to be here this morning. Excuse me, I'm just gonna take this thing. Is it like that way? Okay. So very happy to be here this morning for this kickoff session of the Digital Media Day. For those of you who don't know the Canada Media Fund, maybe I'm going to just start very quickly on that by saying that we were created in 2010 by the Canadian cable and satellite distribution companies, as well as by the government of Canada. And our mission is actually to support the creation and production of television programming and their related or extended multi-platform experiences. So those two things in Canada come together, television and related digital media components. We also administer an innovation fund that is completely dedicated to innovation in digital interactive content, as well as technologies and software applications that are dedicated to the cultural sector. So great. We are a leading player in funding content in Canada. So maybe you will ask why exactly I'm in front of you to discuss, you know, the state of digital media. Well, the reality is that we have two other very important parts to our components, you know, to our mandate, and that is promoting Canadian content here and elsewhere as well, and developing and fostering industry intelligence. And this is where the Industry and Market Trends Department that I head is actually positioned. So part of our role is to monitor, analyze, and disseminate back information and market developments that are shaping the content industries right now and in the future. So among several other publications, each year we publish twice a year our Key Trends Report. Today, I'm going to share with you some of the key transformational trends that we have identified and that we've been analyzing and observing in the digital media space. So just for your information, know that those reports, along with more than 27 other industry research studies, white papers, are available for free download on the CMF Trends website. I'm very happy because as of this afternoon, we have a dedicated platform for CMF Trends publications. You will find as well hundreds of blog articles on a plethora of topics that are related to the evolution of the digital media, audiovisual, film, and television industries, as well as a very comprehensive resource on crowdfunding specifically designed for creators in Canada and elsewhere. So that will be launched this afternoon. So excited. We're not in the corporate website anymore. So please go ahead, put that in your favorites. Okay, that was the end of the shameless 30-second plugs. So let's jump into this. Unlike other trends report that you might have, because there's a lot of information out there, right? So unlike other trends report that you might have read elsewhere, the CMF's approach to analyzing trend is not about making predictions or predicting the future. It's not neither about surfing on short-lived news. So I won't comment this morning things such as the release of a new iPhone, for instance. So instead, we have decided to really focus on transformational trends that have been phenomena that have been underway for quite a while and that are steadily evolving in a way that they are transforming fundamentally and in a permanent way the way that television and film industry works nowadays. So we have regrouped these phenomenons or these key trends in six key trends or mega trends, if you'd like. And I believe they pretty much describe, you know, the state of digital media today. And they regroup both challenges and opportunities that, you know, the evolution of the content ecosystem is presenting right now. So the first of them is called always on, and it refers to hyperconnectivity. That's a reality we need to deal with today. So hyperconnectivity and Internet of Things. You've probably heard about this prediction from Cisco saying that by 2020, there will be on the planet 50 billion connected devices available for 8 billion humans on this earth. So what it means, and we can feel that already, of course, you know, is having a readily available devices and multi-access points to the network all over the place, in our pockets, at work, at home. And we know now that it's moving towards being embedded in our furniture, on our clothing, on wearable devices. So it's everywhere. And this hyperconnectivity, of course, opens, you know, the access to content 24/7. So that leads to the second key trend, which is screen convergence, that really speaks to how the behavior of consumption is profoundly changing, you know, on the user and audience side. And I will delve a little more into that one in a few minutes. We also speak about transmedia, the T word. However, we refer to transmedia in a broader way than we're used to hear in the industry right now. And it really talks for us to the cross-pollination, not only of different means of expression, you know, and the creation of interesting and deep story world, but it also talks to the cross-pollination of different media sector. And that is mainly led by the fact that video format has become the main way of expressing an idea, a content, promoting a brand, and so on. We will also delve a little further into that one. The fourth key trend is, of course, the new role and empowered role of the audience. Of you or users. So it's really, and we call that power of many, and you will see why we call that that way in a few minutes. The two last ones are more, talking or related to really the digital economy. So monetization is where we regroup everything that is related to emerging like business models and revenue models. And our stake on that, essentially, is to say that it is true that there's a lot of emerging, not really stable models for the moment, but pretending that there's no business model or no digital economy is untrue. It is growing, it is developing, and it is real industry dollars. So this is the chapter on monetization usually that, and it is a major key trend also that we continue analyzing. The big and the agile really refers to how the competition or competitive landscape is evolving right now. And of course, it refers to all the new players that we're seeing in the creation, production, and distribution space of content. And our stake on that is that the new ecosystem right now, the content ecosystem, is actually polarizing between what we call the big and the agile. So on one hand, big corporate groups, you know, whether media conglomerates or vertically integrated media companies that really concentrate the means of production and also the revenues. And on the other hand, more agile, you know, low-cost, turnaround players, very, very often self-distributed and independent producers. And we could even add on top of that the very big. Like, we have identified, of course, that right now, you know, the ecosystem is under, like, the leadership of five big web giants, you know, that are not only concentrating means, but also own global audiences, data, user data, and technology. And that, of course, you could recognize, and I'm not going to name them. No, it's not true. So, can you help me on that one? Google? Who do you think the five bigs are? Google? Apple? Who? Yahoo? No. Amazon? Netflix, I'm in the media industry, so Netflix, and Facebook. There you go. Today, I'd like just to delve a little more into three of those key trends that we've been observing in order to provide you maybe some updates or further insight on those. So the screen convergence, as I said, is really referring at the shift of audience behaviors, you know, due to multiple access points. So it's leading really to new consumption patterns and to increase expectations on the user side. Sol Berman, who's the head of innovation at IBM, declared 2 years ago that we had to stop thinking that consumption of content was only on demand or mobile. We also had to consider that now it's also getting multitasked and social. In other words, everything is becoming more complex, and it's becoming more complex to understand what the audience wants. This is leading, of course, to greater expectations on the audience side. And this is particularly true when we're talking about professionally made content, i.e. the content that you and us, are, us, our producer stakeholders, are doing. So, this actually leads me to just a side comment. When we're talking about the audience expectations, we also have to stop thinking of the audience, you know, as a singular block of needs. There are some of them that wants to remain passive viewers. Some of them wants to participate just on a peripheral way to content. And some others are really seeking for that deep media, very involved, interactive experience with content. So it is definitely becoming complex. Not only the audience is actually looking for better executed and better integrated content experience, but what we've been noticing as being a major shift in the last, and will continue to be in the next few months, is really a desire for unrestricted access to content. So on that end, in early 2014, you know, we reported on the growing popularity of virtual private networks that allow more and more typical internet users to bypass right management barriers, such as geo-blocking, for instance. Of course, you've been following as well as we do, you know, all the issues and examination of laws regarding net neutrality, both in the US here and as well in Europe. So those are big issues. But what is interesting about, and I'm coming back to the VPN growing popularity, is that piracy for a certain time, you know, was a matter of, you needed to be a geek or a tech-savvy person to go there. And as we speak right now, we have a big part of online audiences that are slowing engaging in some sort of democratized piracy. And consumers are not the only one that are shifting their mindset about piracy. Well-established media players have openly admitted to using piracy sites to help them identify either consumption trends, identify what they should purchase in terms of content, or engage with superfan. On this matter, I actually encourage you to stay, you know, for the next panel, and here, pay really a close attention of the partnership, very bold partnership that Draft House Films and BitTorrent stroke together. You know, Draft House Films actually found a way to leverage the power and powerful, very power potential of the peer-to-peer networks, turning what was could potentially be a threat into really a very powerful marketing tool, gaining more exposure and providing and triggering more, delivering more added value content to their audiences. So stay tuned for that story. The second one is about transmedia, right? So, and what, as I was alluding earlier, what we're talking about here is not only content has become platform agnostic, but it also more and more becoming media agnostic. What we mean by that is that everybody wants to be part of creating, producing content, and especially, you know, into the whole programming original content. So, and this includes non-audiovisual players that are now using moving images as the main way to communicate content. So it doesn't matter whether, you know, they are a car-selling brand like Lexus, or previously, formerly a DVD distribution company like Netflix, or a radio like BBC Radio, or the New York Times, you know, that is launching a new content, video content channel, or even a gaming studio like Ubisoft. But so a lot of non-traditional audiovisual player coming into the field and creating this programming is one thing. Knowing, however, that those are established company with a lot of means, able to create huge competition for the talent, the scriptwriters, you know, and attracting a lot of the talent that was traditionally only sitting in film studios and television broadcasters. Relationship. In parallel of that, you have a whole new breed of creators that is now strongly established, reaching millions of eyeballs supported by self-distribution and self-branding culture. And of course, you know what I'm talking about. YouTubers. They were given the tools by YouTube to create this new culture, and now this platform has an absolute dominant position that is occupied in the video distribution space. I don't know if you saw that that yellow thing here, the guys in red, top five most influential between 13 and 18 years old. This is a survey conducted in July by Variety. These are YouTubers. The red dots are YouTubers' personalities. And they actually superseded, you know, like mainstream celebrities, including Leonardo DiCaprio, which is the last one here. That is between 13 and 18 years old. Okay, so that is what we're at right now. We're heading towards a new content ecosystem that is not only about just building, you know, when we talk at CMF about transmediation, it's not only about building sophisticated story worlds. It's a whole new content world shaped with new narrative formats, hybrid forms of media, and new breeds of creators. And now, if you're a television or a film creator, there's no way you're living alone on that little bubble. You're blending. Everything is blending. Let's move quickly towards power of many. This is the last key trend that I will want to focus on today, and certainly not the least. We've noticed, you've probably seen already this image somewhere out there on the web, you know, those that big aggregate little fish eating the big one. So we've noticed several years ago already that the audience was slowly moving, you know, towards a passive viewer's position, towards a more participatory consumption. But there's very few of us who could have said that after less than 36 months, something like crowdfunding, for instance, would become a $5 billion in raised money across the world. And that almost a quarter of that is for creative art and cultural projects. In 2009, Clay Shirky declared, "Every time a new consumer joins this media landscape, a new producer joins it as well." Well, this is today. The users are not only deciding when and where to consume content or with whom to share it. They want to be part of the creative process through crowdsourcing or user-generated content. They want to curate and finance through crowdfunding. They want to co-distribute and co-market their favorite films and programs. What industry stakeholders, and maybe you're too far to read this, but what we need to understand is that part of the other audience has become makers. What participative audiences are saying, we don't want to just consume content, we want to make it ours. So, by getting involved as a maker, what is actually happening, and this is very important, is that audience members are actually adding value to the content, to the brands, to story. Let's just remember that audience has their own audiences. And hence, you know, what used to be the intrinsic value, and I'm talking about cultural value or even economic value, that was formerly intrinsic, like within the content, is now part of that relationship that the users are creating with those contents. And hence, they're adding value, you know, across all the process when they're either sharing, amplifying, mashing up, aggregating, editing, and so on. And so I guess the challenge, you know, for us right now is really to see how traditional creators and producers could explore and understand how they can activate and capture part of that value, you know, that resides on the audience side and turn that into real industry dollars. Just a very quick example about that, on using audiences as makers. ABC, that's the Australia public broadcaster, actually developed a show, a TV show that is called 7 Days Later. It's a TV program that was marketed as Made by You. And for this show, the audience was actually submitting the TV brief. It was providing the premises. Is that your mom? If that's your mom, you should answer. Okay. So you just, in this show, what am I talking about? 7 Days Later. So the audience was actually providing the premises of the show and the brief, and the creators had, hence the title, 7 days to develop the dialogues and the plots and the themes, and then the show was broadcasted. Well, that TV show was awarded an Emmy Award during Cannes last spring. Anyways, so what is the state of digital media? Doing just fine. doing just fine. I guess the real question is for the television and film industry to understand how we can continue, you know, that adaptation process. Because it's not going to stop. Those key trends I just alluded to and those examples I gave you are not going to fade away. They're fast evolving and they're steadily growing. So I just want to finish, and please bear with me because I'm going to go very quick overview, but I really wanted to share these very inspiring examples to let you know that adaptation is not only desirable, but is absolutely possible. All of these examples are taken specifically from the film industry and showing that all the phases of a value chain, you know, can actually be reinvented. Three out of those examples are Canadian initiatives. So this is where I re-become the CMF. Very quickly, Cinecoup, each time, just tell me who've heard about these projects. Cinecoup. Okay, developed by a Vancouver-based company, is absolutely a disruption in developing and in the way you can develop, market, and finance your project. Cinecoup is actually a film accelerator for indie film creators. You can actually submit a 2-minute trailer that is then funneled through a gamified process by which the audience is voting. And building your fan base is actually what's taking you up, you know, into the whole funnel. So after that, the projects are brought to industry decision makers. The top 10 are actually optioned for development, and a jury that is composed by industry members and fans actually vote for the big winner, and that was last year's big winner, Wolf Cop. They were earned $1 million to produce their indie film, and you liked it, eh? What? Really? Oh, you have to talk to this girl afterwards. Anyways, so say to Jay that I'm talking about his project. So anyways, the thing is that it has been awarded $1 million to do this, and actually the whole is released, the film is released in all Cineplex theaters across the country. I'm gonna go very quickly. Just finishing that. Connecting the Dot is actually a new twist on audience engagement and new approach in promotion. This initiative is also Canadian. It's by Open Cinema. They organize hybrid cinema events. They combine live documentary screenings in two different cities. And then venue-to-venue interaction via Skype, you know, for the audiences to exchange, and also post-screening discussions on Ustreams, and moderated, of course, social media gatherings. So this is a very, they've done that in three places so far, and it's giving pretty good results about how you can actually create those virtual gatherings plus live screenings events. Merchler application is actually an augmented reality. It's an instant conversation starter. So this is more for the promotion of films. It actually provides, they develop, it's a Montreal-based company. They develop interactive movie posters. And so what you do is you pass your tablet or your phone, you know, in front of a movie, and actually triggers, thanks to image recognition, it triggers trailers or extra content and so on. So think about the kind of kick-ass QR code kind of approach. They've done that for big American films like Django and Hunger Games and Sarilla. This lady here produced a great animation film, and Sarilla was using Merchler for their promotion as well. So you can talk to Nancy afterwards. This is a French initiative. It's a democratized approach to film programming and local theaters. So it's really easy. It's a web platform. It bridges independent theaters and independent films, and the user actually gets to vote for the film they want to watch near their house. And if you actually reach the threshold, then the film is programmed. So you just go, you pre-book your seat, and you go to the theater and watch your film. So it's really about democratizing film programming in theaters. And finally, this is the last example. Cinema City is an engaging user experience that could revolutionize, long tail and back catalog exploitation. But because we really care about that, right? It's not only about once we have released the film. It's actually how can we exploit also back catalog? And this is really important. So this is actually a kind of an application that allows you and allow the user to watch a scene from a movie and soon eventually from a TV show at the exact location it was shot. So in other words, it's a geolocalized video player and recommendation tool. As you're wandering around the city, this was launched in Paris, but it has become so popular that now they have the Berlin and the New York version of it. Okay, so, and this is actually talk to another very emerging and growing trend, which is the need, you know, for virtual reality and virtual and real life to blend together. I think I have to stop talking now. Is that the case? There's 1 minute left, but actually I'm done. So thank you for your attention. And I hope I just not did too much stuff in too little time, but if you do have questions, please go ahead. Go ahead. Yes.
Thank you. My name is David. I'm from South Africa.
Hello, David.
I'm trying to figure out where we fit in the rest of the world. So in terms of your planning and your forecast, whether it's just for Canada and who they relate to, whether it's the States or Europe, does Africa feature anywhere in your research or in what you guys look at?
Okay.
Especially if
CMS? Can I tell you that we all have the same question? Where are we sitting in this big, big picture? One thing we're sure of. So first of all, to your question, we're not specifically covering Africa per se, but absolutely, we're not looking only in Canada. What we do, you know, and what you will find, for instance, I don't know if you saw, but on the main page right now on the website is the growing digital media industry in Latin America. So we do cover what's going on abroad. And this is super important. Why? Because the CMF is convinced of one thing. We're part of a global digital world. That's it. So we're all in the same content ecosystem right now. And Africa certainly have a part of that. The question, and we all have the same question, is how, culturally speaking, I guess, you know, we need to continue defending and having real a cultural position in that. But that's the question everybody's asking. Yes, please. Hello.
My name's Andrew.
Hello, Andrew.
Catalina?
Yes.
You mentioned before you had the YouTubers and there were the red dots
Yes.
that were more prominent, or you said they
superseded. Yeah.
Yeah, they superseded you know, huge Hollywood stars.
Mainstream. Yes.
In what sense was that? Just an awareness of by
Yeah, it is a very good question. The way the survey was conducted, it was actually it was a survey, so it was like around 1,500 you know, young people, mostly English speaking. And what they did is they actually gathered 150 celebrities, and they gathered them from being both from YouTube, but also celebrities that were scoring high in the use. I don't know if some of you know this, the Q score. The Q score is like an American standard for awareness of brands and celebrities. But the criteria to your question were really about influence, authenticity, and how do you say that? Accessibility, the ease of accessibility to these celebrities. And so YouTubers ranked like there was six YouTubers in the top 10, and the five first position were occupied by YouTubers that you and I probably don't know about.
Because we're old?
Actually, I must say 13 years of experience, that's not true. I really have to review that. I'm a little older, getting older. Yes.
Is that chart on the CMF site?
Which chart?
The YouTubers.
No. But write to me and I'll send you the article. It's on Variety. It's a survey that was done in Variety. I'm pretty sure actually if you Google survey YouTube Variety July YouTubers and so on, you will find it. And that chart is in there. The infographic is in there. You got it? Yes. Are you from Latin America?
Yo
también. Rene wants me to stop making jokes. Yes, it is. It is. It's a great article that has been released, and it's about the growing digital media industry in Latin America. Hey, it was a pleasure talking to you.